Hi, I'm Ed Sperling. I'm the Editor-in-Chief of Semiconductor Engineering. I'm over at Advantest with Ira Leventhal. I was going to talk today about deep learning and how that's starting to change what's going on in the semiconductor industry. Ira, we've heard a lot about AI, neural networks. What type of impact is this having on both design, the manufacturing of chips, and also how they're used out in the marketplace?
Well, we're starting to see a much greater adaption of these artificial intelligence, neural networks, deep learning capabilities within the semiconductor industry in a variety of ways, all the way through the semiconductor value chain, starting in manufacturing space and then going all the way through to test. The approaches are being used to come up with better ways of testing, to be able to tune manufacturing processes, to be able to come up with more efficient ways of stepping through from one stage of the process to another. And there's a tremendous amount of research going on just in the last few years for how these technologies can be successfully adopted within the industry.
So there's AI chips, but AI also is being used completely, AI deep learning are being used completely across the supply chain as well for the design, the manufacturing, and also the test of these chips, right? It becomes a much more integrated part of everything we do.
It is becoming that way. I would say there has not been adoption of these techniques in a real serious way within the semiconductor industry up until the last few years. And if you look at the research that's been done both within educational world as well as the industry, that has really ramped up over the last few years, and you're seeing these approaches being applied in a variety of ways, from design all the way through to manufacturing and then through to test.
So why don't you take us through some of these things? So why don't you take us through some of these developments?
Sure.
So what's the solution to this growing complexity?
So we talked about some of the issues with the shallow neural network architectures, the inefficiencies, the inaccuracies of those architectures. To solve that problem, the concept of deep learning was created. And so what I've diagrammed out here on the board is a deep learning network. The way that that differs from the shallow neural network architecture is you've divided the problem out into this series of layers of the neural network as shown on the board. And I'm showing an example here of if you feed in, let's say you've trained a deep learning network to recognize images, you've now divided the problem into a series of steps where your first layers of the network will recognize some of the edges of the image. And then that will get passed along to the next layer of the network where it will put those edges together into textures. Then those textures will get passed along further into the network where you'll be able to recognize parts of image. And in this case, you see eyes, nose, various features. And then finally, the network will recognize that this is an object, in this case, a person. So it's very similar to why you would want to do this is very similar to why you would have an automobile assembly line, where you've divided the problem into a series of steps rather than just telling one person or one machine, okay, build this complete car. So you have the efficiency of dividing the problem up into steps like that. And also, you can think of it like the same reason why you would build skyscrapers. If you only have a certain amount of, in this case, computing resources to use, the deep learning network will use those resources much more efficiently, both in terms of memory and computational power. Just like a skyscraper would be able to get a lot more built on that single piece of land.
What's different, though, is that with an automobile assembly line, if something fails, you generally can go back and figure out why did that fail. What you're dealing with here is almost a series of black boxes, right?
In a sense, yes, but there are ways of being able to look in more detail at each layer of the network and what that's putting out, and you can do some tuning based on that. And that is something that there's more research being done on how to do that. That, I would say, is one of the key issues right now with neural networks in general, is that there is this black box sense of what's going on in there. And so more work is being done to try to uncover some of the mysteries of that black box.
Where does test fit into this?
So there's a variety of ways in which these approaches can be applied in the area of test. Some of the things that we're looking at Advantest are how we can apply neural networks to do tests more efficiently. Let's say if you divided your test at either wafer sort or final test into a series of steps, there may be better ways of doing that test that your deep learning network can figure out for you, or even how to relate the results from one test insertion to another. You can do analysis using the deep learning tools to be able to figure out the most efficient ways of moving all the way through your test process.
And this is all being developed as we go, right? Because this is all brand new. There is no set way of doing this yet.
Yeah, this is a really important point about how to apply this deep learning and neural network technology in general. There's types of architectures, for example, like convolutional neural networks that people are very familiar with. And so once they understand convolutional neural networks, they want to try to solve all problems using that architecture. When in reality, there are many different types of neural network architectures and new ones that are being developed all the time that are right for different types of problems.
So how do we move forward with this? Is it a combination of you know exactly what you're testing with the chips and you add in other things as you go forward, or do you have to completely redefine your DFT strategy?
I would say that's something that's a work in progress. As I mentioned, the research on this has really ramped up in the last few years now. And new techniques are being applied all the time. We're also looking at where supervised learning, like what I've described here with this convolutional deep neural network, where that can be applied versus techniques like unsupervised learning can apply. So this is something that we're going to need to sort out over time.
Are there going to be multiple types of tests here as well? Is it going to be, for example, BIST as things get out into the marketplace, as well as the standard ATE type of testing?
Well, that's a really important point, is that the deep learning, there's both like neural network hardware and software algorithms being developed. Those are going to be applied in a variety of ways, some of which we understand and some of which we have no idea of even being able to predict right now. And that hardware and software is going to need to work properly in these new applications after it's shipped. So certainly something like built-in self-test is going to come into play very heavily there to be able to ensure that the hardware and software together are doing what they're supposed to do.
ATE has typically been thought of as sort of a slow-moving portion of the industry. There's a lot of techniques that are there and in place, and they've been built upon for years. What you're talking about here is really running very fast to keep up with the new technology, right?
It's definitely running very fast, and I would imagine that if you ask me that same question, let's say even 1 year, 2 years from now, we're going to see a variety of technologies that are coming into play that maybe we never even heard of 1 or 2 years ago.
What are we looking at here?
So I want to give you an idea of why the transfer learning gives you an advantage. Talked about the idea of, just like with a human, we take the learning from one context and apply it to another. Well, how does that actually help you? So what I plotted out here is, this is showing the training of a neural network when I don't use transfer learning, and then when I apply the transfer learning approach. So without the transfer learning, the network will learn over a number of training epochs, and it will, at some point, it will level off to be that, you know, that's the best error it's going to be able to achieve. When I'm able to take the learnings that I applied from the other context and use that with the transfer learning, I get three advantages. One is, actually, when I start training, I start at a lower level of error. You can see the error level decreases faster as I go through my training epochs. And then the amount of error that I'm able to achieve at the end, even after a long period of training, ends up significantly lower than if I'm not applying transfer learning.
This has fairly significant implications on the manufacturing side as well, too, right? Because now you can apply this kind of knowledge in terms of, we know this is going to help you get better yield on your chip, and there's going to be more fewer errors in those chips.
Yes, absolutely. One of the problems that we face within semiconductor manufacturing test is that we're always manufacturing new devices, we're testing new devices. We don't have a lot of data that's built up on those specific devices, but we can take all the learnings from the previous devices that have been either manufactured or tested, and then apply that in the manufacturing test of the new devices that we're coming out with.
What's the real world application of this?
So the great applications for transfer learning are any time where you don't have a lot of data on, let's say, some new technology, some new piece of equipment that you're working with, and you want to apply the learnings from your previous generations of technology into devices. And one area that a Korean university team has been looking into is how to apply transfer learning on what's called virtual metrology. The idea of virtual metrology is within semiconductor manufacturing, rather than having to measure the wafers that are coming out of your manufacturing process, which is a time-consuming and costly process, you want to be able to predict that performance using the settings from your equipment as well as readings from sensors in the equipment. The problem is that you need to generate quite a lot of data from any equipment set in order to be able to do that kind of prediction. This Korean team has figured out how to use transfer learning to accomplish this. And so what they've done is they've built a deep learning network architecture where they've taken the learnings from the previous sets of equipment, and they've applied that. When they get a new set of equipment, they do, let's say, a smaller amount of data. They collect a smaller amount of data on that equipment to be able to do the virtual metrology process, and they've been able to come up with some very successful results.
How effective have they been?
The work that the Korean team has done has been very effective, and I'm showing an example of it on this plot here on the right. This is basically the same curves that I showed previously, but in this case it's showing the real data from their experiments. And so I'm showing three different lines on the plot here. This upper line is showing the results they were able to achieve if they were not using transfer learning. And then the other two plots show two different types of transfer learning approaches they used with this virtual metrology problem. The green line is what I showed before, and that's where they freeze the earlier layers of the network and they retrain the subsequent layers on the new data. And as you can see, that gives you the best possible performance over time. This third line is a different technique they used where they used transfer learning to set the weights of the new network for the new equipment, and then they allowed the entire network to be retrained by the new data. And the results were very interesting. It showed that if they did only a limited amount of training, they could actually achieve a better a lower rate of error, but then over time as they did further training, the error actually started increasing and started asymptotically approaching the network where you were not using transfer learning. And the reason for that is basically as you train the network further and further and let that transfer learning information be retrained, you're essentially losing that learning over time.
So really you're only as good as your good data and clean data as opposed to all the data.
Yes, you're basically, rather than being able to take the combination of that the good data from those previous sets of equipment and add to that the new data, essentially you're forgetting that good data over time, and you don't have enough new data on the new set of equipment to achieve as good a rate of error as if you were using the transfer learning process.
Ira Leventhal, thanks for a great explanation of a really complicated and developing subject.
You're welcome. Thank you.